think that's right.
Okay, so we'll fill that in. Anyway, for those of you who were here, if you wouldn't mind just reading it carefully.
Is Terry just absent for today, or is she just... Spelling type of matter?
Sure, I mean...
No, it's D's also.
It's a big deal, Barrett Place.
Barrett Place, yeah.
Two T's.
And a capital B. Second page. Only the two L's. Under significant tree ordinance. All right, now we're getting ridiculous. My daughter's name?
I wonder if that was right.
It's actually M-A-D-E-L, so it's Madeline Lombard, Lisa Madeline.
Yeah.
The last bit is, the Len part is E-I-N-E.
For the record.
There's an extra one there, I see.
Oh, is that number of trees?
That's because I couldn't remember...
Oh, the fifth one?
The fifth tree.
Oh, right.
It's the elm on Con Street.
Right.
So elm on Con's.
I don't remember the part about the cemetery.
Oh, yeah.
The stumps.
Okay.
Page bridges is with, I think, the ends. Under polygons.
Do we even have, they are not on the agenda. That's your, yeah, our discussion. Is it, where it's...
Planting here.
Yeah, it was...
But I have forgotten, what was the gentleman's name?
His name was Sebastian.
Sebastian.
Goot. Goot something.
I don't know the word.
I can get the name.
I think you're on the right track.
Sebastian is his first name, but I...
Look up Conway School.
Yeah, I'm looking.
That's probably the easiest way to find it.
Sebastian would be...
Regenerative design.
Oh, yeah, he was with you.
Page.
Hello, okay.
And...
Talking about what she done, Julie.
Yeah, so I mean, I think the gist of that is, Lily suggested connecting the two parties, Lily Dick and Page. His last name is Gutwine. Gutwine. G-U-T-W-E-I-N. So I just want to revise the summary there, because I feel like this doesn't quite capture it. It was really about a potential... Lombardi, the grounds manager at CDH, with the two people who were present at the meeting, Sebastian and Paige, in order to discuss on broader reason.
Did you say, was there going to be any follow-up on the volcano mulching on King Street?
I was just going to bring that up today.
Okay.
There was, we didn't come up with any decision.
Is that on the agenda?
It's not on the agenda. I was going to either squeeze it into chair report or any other business. Okay. You can also squeeze it in your time.
I have way too much more time.
So much more.
That's funny because you're talking to yourself.
I talk very good. How are we doing, folks? Are we ready to?
Quick question on the motion to approve the previous, I mean, no vote was made in the second round.
Yeah, I think we decided that to approve the previous.
I know, that was at the beginning of the meeting. I might have moved that too.
All right.
We could just put that in there. I'm willing to have my input in there.
And I feel like Todd jumps in there really quickly.
Yeah.
Jen, do you remember jumping in there?
No.
Okay, all right. So we'll say Molly and Todd.
All right.
And then we'll also say Molly and Todd for the very end, where it's motion to adjourn. All right, we have a motion to accept these amended minutes.
I move.
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Abstaining?
Aye.
And you're two abstentions. Okay. Good. All right. I think that with the last agenda I sent, I sent a link to our to do list. So from now on, we're going to switch things up. We're not going to go through this review list here. We're going to ask you to please do that as homework. Okay, chair report. So the main one is changing our meeting time. And we had, of all the responses, we had four votes for 4:30 and three votes for 4 o'clock. And the 4 o'clock people said that they could do it at 4:30 if necessary. So can we have a motion to move our regular meeting time, same time of the month, but a different time of the day, 4:30?
I make a motion to change our meeting time to 4:30 on the first and third Wednesdays. Start time 4:30.
Second.
Okay, discussion? Sue, is this a good time for you to chime in?
That is fine.
It's going to work for you?
Yeah.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, unanimous. That's done. And then that's a good segue, since I mentioned Sue, to the vacancy. So Sue submitted an application to the mayor, right?
Yes.
To serve on the tree commission for Rich and my strong encouragement. And do you know if that's been received?
It has been received. Yes, we need to go. Mayor's paper to the council. I'm not sure when I'll follow up with that.
Okay, so until that happens, until you get officially voted in, we're still a six-person commission, which means that if we have three people absent, we'll get you on as quickly as possible.
Stay out of the
yeah. All right. Good. Well, that's exciting. We look forward to having you be a more active participant.
Thanks for your encouragement.
Okay, other chair report items. I just sent into everybody's inbox. Actually, I sent it into Jay's too. Like, I take him off my list. Madeline's draft tree speak language. So that's, maybe we'll let Rich do a first pass of that, and then if anybody else has any, you know, I don't think this needs to be editing by committee. person at Mary Thompson Foundation, because they do have some, you know, we never did sign that document. Did I have a phone to you? Okay, so I was the block here. But they do want us to sign a, like a proprietary document, that, you know, the trees will stay there, they'll be well tended to, and it's, I think that the, something about the nuts, it might be something about the offspring.
Oh, thank you.
I don't know, I have to recall what it says, I can't, but I just have this feeling that it's related to the fact that those nuts are really rare, so, yeah.
One thing, when we think about where to plant those, is just keeping in mind how spiny the shells are, and a lot of people might not want those, like, it might not be great to have them in an elementary school yard.
Well, just like in a swimming pool.
Yeah.
Maybe they have it there.
But just in general, we have to remember that, that they're lovely, but.
So I have to.
It's forestry related.
Yeah, I have to tell this one really funny story, it's a pretty, and that is that right out of college, I worked as a psych tech at this psychiatric institute called Chestnut Lodge, and it was named because it used to be this grand manor where there were chestnut trees everywhere, and I would take the patients strolling in the grounds, and I had this one patient who was constantly rolling on the ground.
Oh.
No idea what she was doing, until I realized that she was rolling onto the spiky shells as a way of.
Self-flagellating, self-painting.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Wow. Yeah. All right, they closed that institution. All right, so, yeah, someone mentioned Loop, someone mentioned Chestnut Street, we'll just keep. All right, and then the last thing is, a few of my chores, I did connect Paige and Sebastian to John Lombardi, who replied fairly quickly that they were already doing a redesign of their entranceway, but I'm trying to just leave it up to them. I'm gonna let them have their conversation as far as it goes, and then if it doesn't go anywhere, then I feel like we should revisit it and maybe proceed with the original plan, which is just for trees. So. I think that's about it for me. I think I got through most of my tasks last week. Neighborhood application form, or from Richard Parent, start moving that onto the website.
There was some neighborhood that had expressed interest in that, right?
Prospect.
Yes, Prospect Street.
Yeah, do we need to let them know when it's up on the website?
I will, I have the gentleman's email. I'll just support it on the website.
Decided at the last meeting that we were going to follow through with this pilot project on Orchard Street.
Yes.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. And that'll kind of tie that whole, neighborhood together. This is I'm sorry, I was just saying that the pilot project on Orchard Street, once that's completed, will kind of tie in. Working down Elizabeth Street, working down over on Lincoln, and also what we started out on North Street, where we actually started doing our actual training, our tree leader training.
Ooh, yeah.
Which, that was what, four years ago? The summer of 2014 or 2000? No, like summer of 2015.
Yeah.
Or spring of 2015. So we still have. So, unfortunately, I'm a little unorganized today, and I apologize. I'm just going to kind of out of the top of my head. So, first and foremost, I wanted to tell everyone that I spoke to a couple commissioners, but so my job is changing. So, I've now been the superintendent of the Forestry Parks and Cemetery Committee. So,
which is a brand new.
Which is basically taking the Parks and Cemetery Division, which is underneath the Highway Division, and merging it with the Forestry group of people. So now so basically all the green infrastructure that DPW is responsible for will be under one umbrella.
I think it's actually a really, it's time. You know, the city has made a tremendous amount of investment in this green infrastructure under this present administration, with Florence Fields, Pulaski Park, multiple rail trail extensions, and then on top of it, we have this huge tree initiative, which we didn't have 5 years ago, 4 years ago. So I think the mayor's recognized that there needs to be a more hands-on approach, in a sense, to the maintenance and care and planning of all these different pieces of the puzzle that actually make our city really what it is today. You know, potholes are a pain, sidewalks are a pain, you know, but people have to get to point A and point B. Green infrastructure is something that's really important. The mayor has made the commitment to really kind of up the ante. So I will still remain the tree warden. I just want to have a title change.
So you won't have to do road stuff anymore?
No.
Potholes?
Negative.
Good for you.
Yeah, it's less stress.
But I'm just wondering how it was nice in a way, because you were, the roads and the trees overlap so much that, do you think there'll still be a way to keep that tight?
Yes, so one of the things that we're going to do internally is that we're going to change a little bit our permits work. So presently, as the highway superintendent, someone comes with a driveway permit or a trench permit, I have to sign off on those permits. And if there's any conflicts with public shade trees, then I will deal with them. So it will just be another line for me to sign as this new position.
Good, so it goes through.
So it will go through four, it'll go through the water, goes through the water division, the sewer drain division, the streets division, the highway division, and this division. And so I'll sign off on it. And that's also where our language will probably live for the public shade trees. Instead of having the public shade tree impact permit, Todd and I have been working on with Alan Seymour, the actual language that Todd is working on will actually be in the permitting part already. So instead of having an extra permit or an extra signature on something or an extra document, it'll all be embedded in the trench permit process. Everybody has to have a trench permit for everything when they work in the public right of way, and even on private property. So it'll be interesting how that language pans out. So that's one way. The other thing that that we also decided to do after some conversation was to include the other green infrastructure. And what I mean by that is like all the roadside mowing that we do with the large sidearm mower, but also all the mowing of the flood control levees. So we have one person that does all of that, so that person will be mowing roads as well. So we'll have, so basically, instead of having a person in the highway department chopping down what he thinks is brush and actually really is trees, that person will work for this division instead. We'll all be on the same page. So the streets division, our highway division, is demanding maintaining the roadways. They're not going to touch the tree belts. They're going to fix the sidewalks. We're going to take care of the tree belts.
What about the trees in the parking?
That's a good question. I think after this division is sworn, we have a bunch of those types of things to talk about. Reality, for example, what's up here, what's done by Felix Lovkin, is that his name?
Yeah. What is it? Help yourself.
Help yourself. You know, those things are 10,000 foot view. So it's kind of, my opinion, the 10,000 foot view is how do we incorporate all those places, get them under one house, and actually get everyone sort of in line with our initiatives and our goals, and how do we get those accomplished? You know, the other large piece of the puzzle with this thing is the school grounds, which presently is run by the school partner. That's a mayoral decision, a mayor question. But there have been times in the past where they have tried to merge the outdoor grounds together as a group, and it hasn't worked. Maybe this is different. But I think we have to get this division organized and actually functioning operationally correctly. And then we will go from there and talk about all those other things. I mean, there's, you know, for just another example is the roundabout. So these little green spaces that are not really managed effectively, they're just kind of falling between the cracks.
Right.
So all, like on Pleasant Street, all that stuff is dead in there.
Oh.
So all those things will come into play eventually, but I think we need to have that bigger discussion after we get this thing together and see how it works.
How big will your team
Let's get real.
Look at, they let me fill potholes, they can't do it. No, I don't know, I think my thinking is sometime in October, because when I move back to the cemetery, there's going to be, I have to recreate a carbon office out of the building for me, which the office is big enough to house meetings, which is nice, compared to my office that I have personally, it's not small. So, in a pinch, we'd actually meet there.
Is Terry going to be?
No, there will be no clerk, all the clerks are going to stay administrative. So that functionality, we'll have to kind of streamline that a little bit, so. It'll be interesting. I'm excited, something new, I got 10 years to go, so it's another mission.
No more potholes, that's the best part, right?
What's that?
No more potholes.
No, let's fill in the trees.
Whoa, you're going rogue, man. I never thought I'd hear that, I love it.
I learned from the best over here. So a couple of things, let's see, I got nothing on my head. Sonic tomography, so we've had three sonic tomography, three locations where we have sonic tomography. Two on Merritt Place, which we talked about, we mentioned our last seven minutes, that's been completed, we're waiting for the report to come back. We had sonic tomography down on a 62.5 inch northern red oak on Hinkley Street. That, I'm waiting for the report to come back on that, but that tree, it's got structural issues. It's also one, the tree that's in the way of the new sidewalk.
Down there?
No.
Hinkley?
No, Hinkley's up off of Nonotuck, between Nonotuck and Riverside Drive.
Is that that huge white oak? I'm not sure if that's Hinkley or the street off of Hinkley.
No, that's Maplewood Terrace.
Oh.
Maplewood Terrace has a multiple large white oaks.
Yeah, yeah.
Hinkley Street has a, it's a northern red oak, from what I can tell.
It's a big tree.
You know, it's definitely 150 years old, probably at least, and it does have issues, but I'm waiting for the report to come back.
If it were
worries me, like a kind of precedent. You know, I think of the Champion Oak on Columbus, which is gobbled the entire sidewalk. And so, is it always a case that the sidewalk takes precedent over the tree?
No, it's just for this particular project, the sidewalk was on that side of the street. That already was an existing sidewalk. So that exists.
But so there's an existing sidewalk at Columbus too. So, I mean, why couldn't that happen there as well?
Well, I suppose it could happen. I can't say it can't happen, but I would think that the statute of that tree, its age, you have to make considerations in the plan. One of the problems too with this project, unfortunately, is this project has been on design for like 10 years. So this project was designed, it was stamped by an engineer, it was finalized prior to actually this commission and myself being a tree warden. So I would hope that now that we are, have this body and the tree warden, that we have some oversight, that we can actually get to the table before these plans are actually finalized. And the other thing too is they did everything they possibly could. They actually air spaded the tree. They did large excavations in front of the tree because they had to replace the water, sewer, and stormwater. But they air spaded and cut all the roots. I was there and watched them. But there really wasn't a tremendous amount of root. There wasn't a lot of root material underneath the roadway. The root material is actually going towards the backyard. The problem with that is that the weight of the tree is actually this way for the roadway. And the other issue is that the crack in the tree, the trunk is in the back. And the cavity of the rot is in the back. And so you have all of this compression wood in the front that doesn't have any, that actually is supported on the tree on a partial root system, where the backside of the tree actually has, there's all this tension wood that is pulling constantly, but it's actually, the wood is not sound. So you have a bunch of not so hot things going on. But I mean, I said, I wouldn't have known any of that if I didn't do the geography. So for me, it's worth just understanding how to use the diagnostic tool. I had a chance to do it, let's say, we'll pay for it. It's important to do it so we actually have an MRI of what's going on with the tree. Sort of like what we did it. I mean, Forbes Library was similar. The foregone conclusion was the trees have to go. This is not that same kind of situation, but it's similar to it. You know,
is it the same with the Bear Place trees?
Yeah, the Bear Place trees they have defects in them as well.
No, but in terms of the, like, there's a development project in this.
No, it's just that they're huge trees in the middle of this very narrow street that are actually into the street, the house right across the street. And they have defects at their base. And it's concerning to me that in a windstorm, and those trees already got damaged severely because of the 2011 ice storm. So, and I've been monitoring these trees. I check them once a year, and you know, their cavities are just getting bigger. So the question is that, you know, when is the time? You know, you never know when a tree is going to fall. You make assumptions based on the tree's condition. You know, by doing a tree assessment, but then there's also a risk assessment that comes with that. That's part of that. That, you know, when does the risk outweigh the health of the tree and everything that surrounds it? You know, the Bear Place is different because it has a lot of targets. There's a lot of parked cars. There's a house that has people in it across the street constantly. So it's not, there's a lot of factors. But I like the tomography because it actually provides me with a diagnostic tool. Like the tree on, I think the tree has no visible cavities. I can't see inside of it. The trees on Bear Street have cavities. I can see them, but I want to know how far the cavities go along.
Do you have the machine at Selfridge? Do you do it yourself?
No, UMass does it for us, and it costs $500 a tree.
Oh.
I have a resistograph that is actually going to be sent out to get recalibrated. But the tomography is nice because it gives you a lot of visuals.
All right, I think we've got to, if we're going to keep on talking with the agenda, that's okay. Do you have anything else
document that he basically was kind of laid out the responsibilities and of each subcommittee. And, you know, basically we read over it and agreed that it was a good enough document, and then he was going to submit it to the, I don't have a copy.
Okay.
He was going to submit it to the commission.
Is this the same document that he presented a while ago, was it at the summer meeting? Is there any change?
I don't know if I was here for that.
I think.
And did you make any changes to it?
He.
He, if it's, okay, so we need to wait for him to send a revised, okay. Okay, so anything you want to say about that? Like, are you making a recommendation as a subcommittee to the rest of us to?
Yeah, I think we could say, I mean, we agreed with what it said. It just lays out, like, what are the jobs of the various groups and kind of whose purview is what and who reports to what, and who's, you know, the tree warden is responsible for these things and, you know, kind of like a roadmap.
So that would.
Okay, I'll ask him to send it to everybody by email so that we'll have had a chance to review it before the next meeting.
He's getting married next year or something.
Yes.
I think he was going to, but he's married. He got married like a year ago.
But that was like, he was like, okay, we gotta do this fast.
But it was last Saturday.
Yeah. Yeah, it was like last. Yeah.
You did.
Yeah. We met.
So he was like really on edge to get off.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
There you have it.
All right, thank you. All right, well, Marilyn is going to present the work that Molly, Marilyn.
I've got two handouts, and to start, I'm going to just hand out one. Yeah, I like to make things as easy to read as possible. Okay, so, this document that you're looking at was something that Molly and Lily and I put together last December in advance of the new year as the subcommittee for the tree planting. We were proposing these five and then an additional sixth area. And as you can see, what's highlighted were our proposed numbers. And I just want to say, just for our perception is that, you know, most organizations have delineations between those who are planning and those who are implementing. And of course, there's always overlap and integration. There's many shades of gray, or with trees, shades of green. So we just formed this subcommittee for coming up with a plan, not to necessarily impose it, but just to say, this is what we're thinking. Some of those on the commission, Jen and Rob, and hopefully eventually Sue, included, you've been more like on the ground planting. But anyway, our intention is to come up with a plan, pass it by the group, and get feedback and continue to adapt it and make sure it makes sense to everybody. So I always put, this is for my own reference, at the bottom, I always like to put the mission of the Tree Commission because it just reminds me what we're all about. So here's the second handout. And we met again a couple weeks ago, and we took these five original areas, five that became six, and put it into this spreadsheet. With the mayor eager to put forth a five-year plan, we plugged in the numbers and we made some adaptations. So the first column, priority trees, we also included downtown areas, and we dropped that number of trees per year to 125. For Arbor Day planting and purple column, that stayed at 15, well, actually dropped down a little bit to 15. Neighborhood planting stayed about the same at 20. Ward requests stayed about the same, 15. And then we added more to the ad hoc opportunities, unforeseen opportunities. So you can see the year-by-year tally and the total tally. And what we are just putting forth is the question, how does this look to you? And then can you help us fill in the details? That's sort of the skeleton of our meeting. And before we go any further with any discussion, any thoughts about any of the numbers or the process?
We're in the ballpark. Like, that's a substantial I think that we can afford ourselves that kind of flexibility, and maybe even the way we look at the ward-based requests, maybe we should change this to 21 per ward over 3 years instead of 7 per ward per year, whatever.
Yeah, when you look at the 3 years, you'll find what happens, what focus in the neighborhood. For a while, because people hear about you, you're kind of there, things happen, and then go away. So like,
right.
It won't go back. So I spent some time in like Florence.
We're looking at areas where there's heat identifying those, we send them to your committee. And your committee does the on the ground. Like, for example, at this last meeting, we really identified this area around at the intersection of Cont and Old South and Maplewood Shopping parking lot and, you know, where Center Street comes up. That is, you know, Felix Lufkin's zone. That area needs street trees so badly. So we've identified that, we sent it to you, and you guys basically come up with the planting plan. That list of trees and all of that.
Yeah, that's cool.
And if we can stay like a year or even more ahead of this, then we could really start, this could start feeling more proactive.
To what extent does the mayor need this filled out by the end of this morning?
That's a good question.
How many details does he want? Like, we can give him the numbers, but does he want a little something in each of the boxes to describe?
Good question. I don't know the answer.
Maybe we should share with him the spreadsheet where it's got all these different areas where we're working, because I feel like we can't fit all the ways.
So the way that it works, the capital improvements request will come from the DPW. We have to create, we have to basically give Donna the information that she puts in the capital budget that would be presented to the mayor.
So is that just, you know, over the next 5 years, we're going to plant 1,250 trees, or maybe we should round it up to 1,500 just to be ambitious?
That would be something you could do, you know, if you want to do some hardscape projects.
Yeah.
You have to have associated costs with hardscape projects.
For the capital. This was our chance to kind of not have to, like, have to get grants anyway, but, you know, if we had a dollar value for a tree pit in downtown Northampton, okay, so then we know this is our ballpark tree pit. So each year we want to do replace three downtown trees. We're not going to plant four Florence tree pit or Pleasant Street trees, you know. It's going to cost, normally would cost X to plant trees. Now it's good. For those areas, it's X plus.
You know? It's very difficult to plant some of the heat islands because they're where there's no soil. So,
So it's going to cost a lot more money.
Yeah,
right. A lot more money.
So I bet, though, if we, you know, it's like a learning curve, I would suspect that after the first one or two or three, there would be some learning curve that, oh, this is the, you know what I'm saying? This, from a logistics point of view, we can do this in X amount of people, X amount of time, you know, procuring that small amount. I mean, that's the other thing, you know.
They might have to do 10
feet at a time. Yeah, I don't really know.
I mean, for a project like that, you know, you have two ways you can approach it. You can actually approach it with the sense that we are actually going to be doing it. So right now, we are doing the capital work. We are doing everything. The only thing that the capital money is providing is the actual tree stock. But we're doing all the tagging, you know.
Yeah.
So in normal large capital projects, you have a vendor that does all that for you. So like, for example, I order a vehicle, I write the spec, I hand it to them, which is the same thing as I write the spec. I want 15 ginkgo trees planted in this location, mulched and watered with water bags. And that's the end of the story. You have a contract with someone. In this case, we are going to be giving them a capital layout that shows us using our own forces with volunteers to get this done. If we were actually going to be doing all those tree planting with, for example, a baby tree or some big tree outfit, that project cost $1,000 to plant all those trees, it's actually going to cost you $3,000. You have to have prevailing wage, you have to pay for their equipment, their health benefits, all my yards. So it makes it change the dynamics. So to say that we're going to plant 1,500 trees in 5 years is all contingent on us continuing this program and having the volunteer support. Because without the volunteer support, we cannot do this. So the big projects, the one thing I want to say, the big projects can be done in two ways. We can actually contract them out to someone and have them actually do the work.
The tree pit.
Yes, the tree pits. If we decide to use the stormwater tree pit model, or if we use the stormwater
what the ratio is like?
No, for example, the stormwater pits they were going to use, they were actually going to take stormwater on Pleasant Street, the treatment plant, it cost $10,000.
Those are like those boxes, right?
Yes.
But then you have to take that tree out of there after a while.
Yeah. So those were 10 grand, 10, 15 grand installed by a contractor to the tree. So, I mean, you know, we can approach it simply that we're going to say that we're going to plant X amount of trees over X amount of time, and it costs this much, a lot of money, and then adjust for inflation. And then every year you have to, so just because we have a five-year capital plan, doesn't mean that we don't meet again. Capital Works Committee meets every year, so that capital plan can be adjusted every year. So that's how we do the public works, the replacement is that we earmark vehicles. So we have a system because the vehicles are of a certain age, they're sort of about, blah, blah, blah. We earmark that for particular years, and then we blow it out to 5 years. But every year we have to reinvent the wheel for that whole program. So if we find 1 year that we're only able to plant 200 trees, we may want to look, because we have lack of volunteers or we just don't have the support, we may have to relook at those other 4 years that are in that plan that are kind of 5 years.
I can imagine that we're looking at a blended approach here, because I imagine that there are some trees, because their location is so challenging, that we can't accomplish the really high quality work that we want to accomplish with just volunteers. So it would be lovely to find out if there are some tree services that do this really well, because we're going to invest the money. And I would argue that in really highly strategic locations, it's absolutely worth investing the money. Not for a 10-year tree, but I mean for a tree that's really going to be there for a long while, like maybe something like at the corner of, this is actually there. Anyway, you get the idea. Like transforming a heat island into a green oasis seems worth the money. So maybe we should start trying to get some numbers around that and then pad that into whatever our year-by-year budget.
Yeah, we could just say we would allow in the budget for, say, whatever, three of those kind of plantings per year, and all the rest are simpler kind. Or whatever ratio makes sense.
Yeah, because, I mean,
I can just see us getting pushed. I mean, I just personally feel like, everyone does it. You just like, oh, crap, we don't get trees down there. People, you know, it's a feel-good thing, whatever. Planting trees in tree pits, you know,
yeah.
And they just die. You know, they just are not. You're never going to get. I've seen so much money in communities thrown at trees, and you know, everybody's excited about it.
Right.
You know, and then you know, 5 years from then, between 5 and 15 years, they're all dead.
So are you saying there really aren't? There isn't such a thing as a viable place for a heat island tree?
Well, it depends on the infrastructure.
Yeah, so
you know, if there's space around, like let's say there's a heat island in front of Academy of Music, you know, they wouldn't want you to put a tree there, but you could put a tree there, and that could be a heat island, but it'd be all right because there's enough green space. But in front of thorns,
don't
that tree is never going to survive.
Right.
And as the trees succumb down our street, you know, down Main Street, which they're going to, there's limited ability, but there is technology to make there be more rooting ground.
I want to clarify, are you arguing, Jen, then, for investing in the right infrastructure? Okay, so you're not saying that no trees will ever survive in downtown.
Oh.
You're just saying under this,
there's
presence
technology.
Or, yeah.
Right. Oh, I thought
right.
That's
right.
I think Thorn Street's
I would agree with Jen. I mean, just go down Pleasant Street and you see the trees that were planted last year by the contractor. And they are, you know, we are barely able to keep them alive.
Right.
Our trees now, we're watering them, but even watering them at the recommended rate of 20 gallons a week is not enough when you have 10 consecutive days when it's 90 degrees and they just aren't going to make it. So I think, you know, we have to look that you have very little green space to work with. So we probably need to revisit that.
Well, that's why we give a whole.
Right, exactly. And then we actually say, okay, it's because Pleasant Street's going to be paved this year. There's no other work on Pleasant Street's going to happen. That would be a place where we could actually make a five-year capital push to actually work on the treatments there, to actually get the correct structural soil or tree box, whatever we decide is really good to use.
I'm also wondering if either in the interim, before we can get the structural soil and other things in place in order for these trees that are planted to have a longevity, is there any possibility of creating either in the interim or perhaps some of the long-term rain gardens? When I was in St. Louis a couple of years ago for a climate meeting, I was so impressed just walking down some of the streets on a lot of the corners, instead of all the water just running off the sidewalk into the sewage, they have these nice plant outs with some stones and other vegetation. At least it's vegetation, not even. And maybe we could work with another group or do it ourselves to incorporate those either, again, as a temporary measure until the trees can go in, or to complement. Has anybody seen any of those in any cities? No?
Philadelphia.
Philadelphia.
They made a huge decision, their whole setup. They made a decision as a city.
Yeah.
Because they had really ancient storm sewer.
Yeah.
So every single park drains, like they have all these city pocket parks, every single one, they totally changed the curb cuts and all the water. There is as much water as possible, either through permeable surfaces or through these kind of catch, you know, these little bump outs and stuff.
Yeah.
They catch most of the storm water comes out. But it was a city decision.
I know about that. They were,
oh,
the decision was they were going to put all their money into green infrastructure that they used to put into gray infrastructure.
Yes.
Really, and actually, I would love Northampton to have that sort of conversation, because I feel like we're in this little narrow box. It's called the Tree Committee. And when you were talking, Marilyn, my little red light was going off, going, it's out of our purview, it's out of our purview, it's out of our purview. But it's like, are the different bodies in Northampton having these conversations that really should be connecting these things? Because trees take in water, so do rain, so do rain gardens. And and yes, what is happening when there's an empty pit for 5 years?
Yeah.
It's doing no good. So I don't know if that's now going to be something under the forestry division, but I think it's a really important point.
Has there ever been an evaluation and plan for Northampton's downtown the way it is?
Well, there is a conceptual plan, and I can't remember a name.
You mean that did the plan?
Yeah, that just.
You mean the bike?
Alta Design Group was selected several years ago to actually do some conceptual plans of based upon what people wanted to see, based upon the infrastructure that existed, what infrastructure people were looking for, different concepts of widening Main Street, narrowing Main Street, creating wider green spaces, pedestrian flow, cyclist flow, parking and parking cars. So there is a conceptual design that actually sits in Wayne's office and has been done based upon these multiple meetings, which actually narrows Main Street a lot and actually creates larger green spaces in front of.
Does it get all the parking off Main?
No, it does not. No, Main Street still has to have parking, because that's one of the biggest problems we have here, is that people struggle to find parking spaces to come shopping, and that's what draws a lot of folks here. So no, but what it did is it did narrow the travel lanes to a singular lane, which would be very interesting. People there was no input, there was no trees planted. We lost the only viable tree belt we had. So here we are 4 years later, or actually that was 8 years later from that project, but 4 years from the commission. And this, we've had a total change in this bush. And I think that we need to continue going forward with that, where like Lily has pointed out many times in all her meetings that she had before we became a body, is that there needs to be a voice at the table for the green infrastructure, particularly city trees, and that is happening. It just takes time. So I think that we're on the right track. I need to get a little more clarification about what they're looking for numbers. My guess is that at the moment would be numbers of trees we want to plant and how we're going to get them planted. So if we're going to continue to use labor, volunteer labor and city forces, then planting 1,500 trees in a 5-year timeframe is very doable. Because this year, I think we'll be over 250 easily.
I just saw this planning 5-year thing as an opportunity
to
hold up the flag of, minimal. It doesn't have to be, everywhere, but just to say,
No, I mean, I think it's worth investigating how much it's going to cost to do some of these improvements and have someone do it for.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Because we're still a maintenance.
Yeah.
We're having difficulty maintaining things.
Right.
And now we have a refocusing to the green infrastructure that will change, but it's just going to take time.
Right, sure.
So do you need any support from us in that piece that Jen brings out, which is the exceptional plantings that would likely cost more?
No, at the moment I don't, because I think I can use some of the design work and the cost estimates for the Pleasant Street project. So that would be, I will try to find those documents from Bayou.
Sure, yeah, that'd be great.
But I think we looked at all of them before, originally.
They were more tree boxes. I know that when they redid the Lord Jeffrey Inn, which they call something else, there are chunks underneath the sidewalk that they planted trees in structural soil. There was certain sections, because I knew somebody that was going to bid on it. So it's happened, and I don't know if the city of Amherst probably has. A bunch of years old.
I mean, I have the plans from Cumberland Farms too.
Okay.
That's a private project. Mm-hmm.
So maybe you two will coordinate with that.
Yep.
And does our recommendation continue to be 5 trees per year? Do we say 5 to 10? Or we're just looking for some numbers so that we can say this is what the committee has recommended, and then you put dollar figures on it.
I mean, I guess it all depends. I mean, for example, the trees in the center of Florence. There's how many tree pits in Florence, so many empty ones, and maybe we can do 5 a year. The money is going to be, so the money is bonded, so that means that once the bond is issued, which usually happens in April of the preceding fiscal year, so the money is for this fiscal year we're in right now, was actually able to be expended in this past April. So we have that revenue. The time clock is ticking, and there's going to be pressure on us to make sure that if we ask for this,
So 5? We're saying 5?
I would say 5.
Okay, and then what the three of us will do is again look at that bird's eye view, and then you all will do the on the ground, like, oh, this is not a suitable site because you didn't know that there were utilities running right through that site or whatever. But we'll give a lot of just very generalized suggestions.
Just looking at structural soil, obviously, you can lift up the panels. There are some places where I can imagine lift up panels, not replace them, and have them very large. In places like Florence, where the sidewalk's wide enough, there are places where the sidewalk's multi-panel wide. You lift out panels, the panel missing from the tree is going to be adjacent to the panel, and it's permanent. So you have a 15 by 3 foot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's structural soil.
Without.
Yeah.
It's always better to put real dirt in there.
Yeah, that's right.
But if you can't, like in downtown,
right.
The idea is that you have from the street to the building.
Yeah, it's under the
space. You would have a hunk of structural soil underneath there, and the tree would have access to 100% of that. It's not every kind of tree species or specific tree species that will survive in those conditions that are recommended and stuff like that.
I'm
how it's done correctly.
So we choose our spots really, really strategically.
We have to be specific in this font.
Okay, so large shade tree, high prominence, exhausted any other option outside of using highly engineered methods of planting. Okay.
And that may be a plug, sorry, in the long run, that when Rich is in on the design of these, you know, I know now we have to put sidewalks on both sides. It's cheaper to leave a hunk of green space, plant some trees, than it is to pave everything and then, or even put structured soil underneath, you know, just if we can, you know.
Okay, this does remind me that I feel like it would be worthwhile checking in with Wayne. You know, I can have a conversation with you about that, but I just wanted to know that we are, you know, we're still really thinking very strategically about these long-term redesigns, and we continue to want early input. I'm not altogether clear if the Alta design of Main Street is locked in concrete at this point. It's not clear to me.
Conceptual design, so there's no engineering.
But is it like 25% done? Is that considered, it's completed? And is it identified places where trees are going to go?
What I can tell, it's probably actually on their website.
Okay, all right, we should probably wrap up this section. It's getting to 6:20 and we're almost done with our subcommittee report section. But one thing I want to remind the committee members who are not part of this little subcommittee to do is please go visit that, do you want me to send you the link again? The Google spreadsheet called Northampton Tree Planting Plan. And just peruse and look carefully at the priority zones. We want your input now, and we want you to be familiar with it so that when you are thinking this tree isn't suited for this location, you can go to priority zone and go, well, what are some of the other locations that we've identified?
So for next steps for the mayor, what would you recommend in addition to this search? Or is that sufficient?
I think that's sufficient. I think we're just going to state that we're going to do 1,500 trees in the next 5 years. And then I've got to do a little homework on, because going back to the conversation we're having, if we were going to be doing 5 tree pits a year, then you have to have 2 things. You have to have an engineering design, and you have to have engineering oversight, 3 things, actually. And then you have to have a contractor.
Yeah. Can those first 2 be in-house, or we have to go to someone?
Potentially right now, I'd have to say it would probably have to be out. But it all depends upon the construction loads that the engineering is doing. It also depends upon if we pick locations that are actually going to be under construction, if the city is going to be doing construction, do we just add that as part of the documentation? So that's another thing that we need to know about. For example, Cumberland Farms, that became a project because they were changing all the sidewalks. So that would be something if the city was planning on doing a large project. Then we would be able to, for example, Wright Avenue. Wright Avenue is going to get paved. I found out the other day they're going to narrow it, which provides us with a tree belt. Wright Avenue, which is the little street that has no trees on it between Pleasant Street and Dunn Street. It's on the backside of the marijuana dispensary.
It's getting narrow.
It's going to get narrow because it's too wide. They want to narrow it.
Right.
But the issue is, so here's an example of, had I had known this prior to that,
are going to be paving, I mean, Hampton Avenue is another good example. You know, Hampton Avenue, all those oaks over there, they've been massacred because they're the wrong tree. They're all pin oaks, they don't belong to any wires, they're terrible. But at least they are doing something over there. They are air spading, they're going to be removing concrete panels, and they're going to be using flexi-pave places where the concrete sidewalk has to remain. So that is a good part of that project, but we need to think a little, even farther and say, you know, if you want to create these treatments in your part of these projects, we have to be in front of that in a sense. So next year, this fall, I'll probably have a list of places that are being paved. So I will know a little more, but that's just an example.
Okay, that's not a bad segue to the next item on the agenda, which is fall 2018 planting planning or planting. And that's Rich and Robinson.
Okay, so how are we doing? What's up?
We're not planting any trees, what?
What's up for the rest of the year?
Actually, Rich and I planted one tree, so we can start.
Yeah, we started.
Before the heat started.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it felt good. This Friday and Saturday are going to be cool. Days after, so we're actually starting planting on Friday morning. Presumably, the weather feasible, we will plant them anyway. We have, pretty much at hand, almost enough trees to set, get to our goal, 130 trees. 27 are already planted. Rich and I have discussed trying to get some bearing trees from this nursery that's in the neighborhood.
Some what, berry?
Shickles?
Berries.
Nurseries.
Yeah, not shickle, but in the place of Western Mass, it looks better.
Western New York.
Oh, so just doing it?
Yeah, Western New York.
Oh.
Way Western New York. So we see their list of trees, we like the trees that they're offering, price. We don't have a amount of energy for this project right now in some ways, because we've got other things, you know, we've already got trees. But I personally see if we have limited enough of the trees. Them and I work, and I say, we feel very interested in whatever we're working on. We can get like 20 trees from them, find out how it will work. You know, like, the condition they arrive in. We might, which I discussed trying.
Yeah, I mean, would it be opportune time to try to do it after leaves drop and hopefully it'll get cooler?
Well, they won't dig them, no.
Right, yeah.
So, you know, a lot of things have to fall in place, but they do. You know, if they're cooperative, we others.
Yeah, that would be interesting. I'm also working on reconciling the setback planting and all the meetings I've had with people. So Alicia and Rob put together a spreadsheet. It's based on a spreadsheet that Tree on Hampton had when they were actually handling some people for setbacks. So I look at it, tweak it if need be, and then add the data that I have into that. So I can track all these people that I've been meeting with and, you know, potentially, I guess in the last meeting, we could have an extra 20, probably an extra 20 plantings. So the setback planting program has kind of gone off the rails in a good way. But it's hard for me to keep up, and I did meet with Tree on Hampton for last Friday.
Friday?
Yeah. Yeah, last Friday.
For the holiday.
And we're going to come up with a plan where I think that the setback plantings, the initial meetings are going to happen between Rob and Alicia with the residents. Actually, the campus, the residents that want the setback trees. And then if the location is suitable and we are able to get them a tree, then I will go there and save the trouble of going twice. So I think we're going to try that model, but I have to get all the data loaded in there first. I think that the more advertising that we do, and the advertising is not only bringing people on setback trees, it's like, hey, I got this problem with the tree here.
Yeah.
Look at it. You know, so I mean, I'm getting bombarded with emails.
Yeah.
And it's just, with all the changes happening right now, it's a little crazy too, so. But I mean, it's a good thing. We'll definitely be over 250.
We're, where are they going to, so that trees is fall? What's the general plan for where they're going?
Well, let's see. Right now, planting a lot of trees. Forests.
Downtown forests, right?
We have a bunch of trees that we can, I mean, we have a whole bunch of locust trees that we can do, again, both in downtown and in the forest, yeah. But we're not doing that at all. Cool, much cooler, because those trees are really challenging right now. But again, that will be forest in downtown. I can divide it more by species than by.
Okay, whatever.
Well, so priority zones.
So Bridge Street, for example, will get finished. Our goal is to finish Bridge Street, so I'm just waiting for, we're going to be painting parking spaces in front of the historic Northampton. And once those are in, then Rob and I have to find some underwire trees, which I think we have some. We need a few more to fit underneath there. And we have some other tree planted at the end of Otter's Road, Bridge Street, on the opposite side, going out before Grand Avenue. And then we're going to go back to Bridge Road and fill in a bunch of vacancies that we have there.
We're doing it Friday.
Yes, we're going to be doing this Friday. So that part of it's Friday, the Bridge Street project will be later on, because we have to kind of arrange, just a little more of an arrangement there.
And going back to North Maple, maybe on Friday, find three more.
North Elm.
I'm sorry, North.
Yes, maybe North Elm.
You know, we talked about swapping some poorly sighted trees on South Street.
Yes.
You know, especially some of those really, really tight columnar trees. Is that, could that happen as well?
Some of those big columnar trees, the big ones.
No, I'm not talking about the ones that are established 10 years ago.
Yeah, we're going to have to probably get
the ones we planted.
Yeah, and ideally the best is going to be Smith College's tree space.
Tree what?
Smith College's tree space.
Oh. Hydraulic.
Tree belt's big enough and it's easy. And it doesn't require very virtually no labor.
Oh, it just gives up a lot of hard work.
We're reducing the hard work.
Yeah.
So that is a possibility. I can check.
Yeah.
See if we can use that. If not, then we'll have to probably have to connect with like Bob Goss.
So you think that 2 years of growth will make it so hard to take the tree out for it to survive?
No, but I mean, really, in reality, we're probably, I don't think so. I think you don't need to report it for taking it out. I just did a pagoda tree. I forgot what it's called, over on Stoddard Street, not your street. We actually pulled the tree out of the ground because it was going to get destroyed. But it wasn't, it didn't meet the criteria of public shade tree. It was too small. So I couldn't have a hearing for it, so I took it out of the ground and saved it. And it's in our nursery now. I'm going to put it somewhere else. I'm going to put it probably in the cemetery to match another tree that's there that's older. But, so it can be done. It's just a matter of, if we don't have the space, then we have to have bodies, and then we have to either maneuver the tree that day and find its new home, or we have to, you know, yeah, we have to be in the end.
Well, I would love to put in a request that the trees that are now, you know, settling into South Street really are not well sighted for that beautiful large tree belt.
So I think you go look at the one, and some of them are actually European corn beans. Yeah, European corn beans, which actually have a spread of 40 feet.
Spreading 100-foot spreading trees and on that corridor, it just seems to me like, let's do it.
So almost easier than removing trees would be to
It is funny. Okay, it's 6:35, and I know we want to get a quick report from Tree Northampton.
And Tree Northampton work is somewhat already covered by all of the safe prep that Alicia and Rob have been doing, both for the street trees, the fall meeting, and starting putting out communications recently to let everyone know that we're going to have a standing Saturday morning, 9 a.m., rain or shine, planting. We were moving towards that last year, and this year looks like that's what we're going to do. So we'll be out there every single Saturday, and we're getting some people plugged in, and hopefully we'll get a lot more people plugged in.
Will there be something on the website as to where it will be each week?
That's a good idea, Marilyn.
Oh, like it probably will be done.
Yeah, there are a lot of moving parts.
Yes.
So we could do our best to do that. I mean, our website lists our Facebook, so probably the most efficient way to do it. Anything we put on a Facebook feed is showing on the website, so that it's always changing. So probably the best thing to do would be to have the locations there. Now, it is good to kind of have some control over how many people are going to be there, because you want people coming out, oh, I'm going to go plant trees, and they get there, and we have enough people already, and they stand around, and they have something to do.
So let me just
do like to sign people up ahead of time and then tell them where we're going to be. That has been our
So on that note, I can see where we plan on Friday. I don't know how many people are up, and so I can try and figure out how many people are, and then there are a near site, and then I can figure out divide them up effectively. And so tomorrow morning or afternoon, I tell Rich how many trees. And so
how many trees will depend on how many people sign up.
Yeah, so
and how many leaders we have.
Yeah. To sign up, we go to the website or call somebody.
Did you get an email?
I did, but I forget what it said. Just reply.
Respond to the email.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, just say, I want to help.
Okay, and it was from you, right?
It was from Tree Northampton.
Oh, from Tree Northampton, okay.
So, yeah, we use that, and then everyone can look at the emails coming in if they feel like seeing what emails are going in and out. So, that's exciting. That's our big news, and
just backing how variable it is. So a lot of the trees will be planting after this batch. We go back to Linden. We're trying to get all the Linden trees planted. They don't do very well with fall planting. And also they're in tree bags, so they're hardier in weather. Then we have to look forward to the weather and decide whether we have those trees in bags, trees and bags, or whether we can start planting the baby trees. So
complicated.
It's really complicated to know what to plant. And so but on that note, just on the plate are is Orchard Street, and so there's having a gate for Orchard Street. Even if it's not kept just internally, like a target gate.
When can we get that? When do you think the website will be up?
I gotta talk about the phone.
Okay, do you have other than Paige, is there a contact at Orchard Street? Okay, all right. I'll be in touch with
Paige. Shoshana.
But you haven't talked to her recently. I'll be in touch.
But anyway, again, because then we can, if we're going to plant that street, then there's fewer trees that we're going to put up sooner. All right.
I definitely want to participate in Orchard Street since that was a great swim. I have a few items that I've thought of in the any other business category. So if we're wrapped up with Tree Northampton.
Yes.
You are? Okay. All right. One is that I put on my Google Calendar a year ago that this is the time to submit a letter of intent to DCR for a grant. And remember, we missed that deadline, and then that was that. I could discuss it with Rich, but it seems to me like anytime we can get the state to pay for procuring material for planting trees, that's a good thing. The other thing I could just explore with Molly Feilischer is whether any of these very targeted, more expensive plantings could be covered.
Do a demo project for the state.
Yeah, a demo project.
And other communities could come and see it.
Yeah.
Make a video when it's installed.
So I'm happy to take this one on, of writing the grant application in coordination with Rich, and I will, at this point, it's going to be something related to, because I feel like Molly's already given us a blessing, related to executing the rough planting plan that we have designed. Because I think she loves to see that we're actually thinking about a proactive plan. And it could be an aspect of it. One aspect of any planting plan could be planting in what are called environmental justice neighborhoods. And for those, if we do a targeted grant like that, I think the match is better. It's more like 75-25. So anyway, I'm going to be looking at the application and at the very least quickly writing up a letter of intent that I don't think has to match perfectly with the application. It's just saying, where we want to put our name in it.
Is there some sort of map that shows that somebody has actually delineated environmental justice neighborhoods?
Yeah, oh yeah. Couple of them. That's census information, Census Bureau information, and that is an overlay that...
SGIS?
Well, it's actually, what's the tree? It's like, there's a tree, tree benefits. It's like some kind of, oh, no, I think it's iTree. iTree has it.
Oh.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, they have Census Bureau information, so there's that.
So we have
and
some
also
areas.
Wayne's office has it.
Oh,
yeah.
Was
that?
Just vaguely, like, around town.
Well, it's kind of weird. I've looked at Northampton, and what, of course, flashes up is the jail and the VA.
Oh.
That's not very helpful.
Yeah.
Oh. But then, of course, you get the various, you know, housing authority neighborhoods, like Florence Heights and Hampton Heights and then Meadowbrook apartments. And then downtown, like Salvo and like and Michael's house.
So Salvo?
Salvo.
And
Michael's.
St. Michael's.
Yeah, yeah.
Salvo has on Cons and St. Michael's on State Street.
So State Street.
Oh, no, not St. Michael's. I'm talking McDonald's house.
McDonald's.
That's what I'm thinking.
McDonald's. Oh, McDonald's house on Old South Street.
Oh, yeah.
Well, so looking at some of the housing, public or funded public, we don't. We don't have a related housing authority.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's federal. We cannot, the only thing we can do is
Three years.
Yeah. I can find out from Molly how close we need to be for it to qualify as EJ planting.
Because I mean, I'm all for it, but it's when you're out on the street looking at part of it.
Yeah. Right. Okay, so I'm going to be working on that. The other thing I wanted to mention is, you know, I would love for us to be proactive, and I mentioned this at the last meeting about volcano mulching, which I'm finding such egregious examples of. I feel like they are demonstration projects.
I totally agree.
To passersby of how not to.
Right.
But passersby might think
this
that's
is
how you mulch a tree.
Right.
And I'm talking about high visibility site on King Street. And then, Rich, I brought to your attention that our own city trees down in the Armory parking lot have all recently been volcano mulched badly with these hostas planted around.
It's actually soil.
Wow.
Well, okay, then volcano soiled. Which is even worse.
In Armory Street?
Holds moisture, yes.
A lot of them are ash trees right now.
So.
No, they have ash, yeah, there are about 10 ash trees. Army Street trees, truthfully, I don't. They're on their way out.
Yeah.
So, the only trees that I have jurisdiction on are the trees on Army Street, and actually, I think the trees on Hampton Avenue. I'm not sure I have.
Well, you have jurisdiction on the ones on King Street too.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So, we may have solutions of how to deal with those particular sites, but I'm thinking bigger, and my bigger thing is I feel like there needs to be signage all along King Street about volcano mulching. Just high visibility before this stuff is removed, high visibility of how, you know, volcano mulching kills. And you get tons, you get thousands of people seeing that and taking it in.
Right, thinking of laws, like...
I'm thinking of just signs that, like, you have...
Campaign signs?
Yeah, campaign signs. And Seth Gregory, who made the little door knocker signs for this topic, like, it's been done, it just needs to get put onto a campaign sign. So my recommendation is that we execute that, and we have a little sudden public campaign.
I like that. So putting up signs before we change the mulching, so people know, like a sign that says volcano mulching kills, and one side with the correct thing with a check, and the other side with an X through it, with a picture, and then that's up for a few weeks beforehand, and then we go and start actually changing it.
Do we know who mulched those on King Street?
I spoke to the primary over there, it's Colvest, they own all that property, and their landscape contractor did it, so they're going to remove it. And they're hopefully going to remove the stuff that's in front of the bank, it's on their property as well. I actually went and had a nice conversation with the bank manager, who actually alluded to the fact that he knew that volcano mulching was poor, but the bank just rents the space from Colvest.
Right.
So I contacted, his first name is Peter from Colvest, who's the operations manager that does all Colvest's ground maintenance.
Colvest?
Colvest.
C-O-L-V-E-S-T.
Yeah, they're going to remove the volcano mulching from their our trees and hopefully their own as well.
Oh, right. And put in the right kinds of the ring?
Okay, well,
great, they're going to do it.
They'll be poor.
But that doesn't mean that we can't do an advertising. It's not usually an advertising campaign or educational campaign in regards to volcano mulching, because you still see it, even at Village Hill, all the work those people did at Village Hill, I still see some landscapers, they went back and they just, the next day they came and they dumped a bunch of mulch around.
So wherever we see it, we can just, boom, right there.
Why are they dumping more mulch?
Because in their contracts, part of it is just contract thing. So if you're a landscape maintenance company, you want to get like yearly stuff. So they do it,
they kill
probably 5-6 trees, well, mature trees over at that place that's right up there. Those were 100% killed by mulch, I would say.
Beautiful maples.
Can we talk to the contractor and say,
well,
find them.
But it's like a, like it's in the contract, people like the way it looks, so you're hiring people that are, they're wheelbarrow, people.
Right, but there's got to be some part of the link where there's some education involved, either with the contract.
In the interest of time, I want to spin this concept, and then we can figure out where we're going to actually put them. So the concept is to create signs that raise awareness about, how this is bad and right in front of the offending, circumstance. And then we can go and have a conversation. But I feel like we need to raise a lot of awareness.
But they have to be on public shade trees.
I'm only talking about
at the bank.
I mean, I would love to do that, but it's like yarn bombing.
We can do that.
Shame on you.
Well, I kind of do like the 1-2 punch, do the signs and then do like send the landscaper copy of our paper.
And remember, we did that.
Yeah.
We have sent that. And we sent a letter that said, and remember, tree mulching,
But maybe there could be phone follow up with them.
Is that kind of things that you sent available for a link so I can print it in on the web?
The letter?
Whatever you sent some kind of package to the
It was sent through Rich's department.
Rich did,
okay. I'd have to wait till I get connected to the city server. I'll take the volcano mulch car markers and see if we can actually create a lawn sign with using the same language that's on it.
Do you want me to take that on with my friend Seth, since he designed it in the first place?
No, I'll just have Marcus print it.
longer, I forgot to put that on the agenda. Any other, we're going to take 2 more minutes if there's any other business, and then we're going to try to wrap up.
Well, can I just have a quick question? At the King Street place, are they going to redo the trees that are in the parking lot area too, or just the ones along the street?
I recommend that you do them all, so you're basically killing your own landscape. And he was very, very valid point, so I'll have the landscape company.
Oh, good, great.
So I don't know if they're going to do everything, but at least they're going to, I told them, my priority is to focus on the trees, because that's what I'm responsible for. However, if they're doing the work, it would be moving, you could remove this, put the mulch in all the parking lot, and any other buildings around that you maintain, you could, you are just shorten the life of those trees.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Lynn, I want to mention, this afternoon, I believe, Molly sent out the email with all the information about different grants.
Yeah.
So before you contact her, read her email.
I don't know if I got it.
Citizen Forester.
Citizen Forester.
Just give you a head start on that before you get in touch with her.
Oh, yeah, okay, I see, it just came in. Great, thank you.
About Forest one?
Yeah, that's a lot of work, I. Okay, thanks. Okay, so we have a motion, to-do list, okay, we're going to do this maybe a little bit faster than usual. So we're going to go around the circle, we're going to mention what our jobs are.
Okay, I'm still working on the community notes list and populating that. I personally just want to contact Wayne and see if I can get those environmental justice neighborhood maps and see if I can put them on a GIS map.
Okay, I can also quickly show you how to do that.
Great.
Okay, I am going to add 2016-2017 plantings, think around, to add the master spreadsheet. And then I'm going to create just a one-page document with all of it that I can share at the next meeting.
Like summer?
Yeah, you can sort it by year.
Are we still working on that list that says where we're putting priority, like we're putting in categories which, of the 2018 trees, which category they're in? Because we have the ones for priority, but we haven't done any of the other.
That's what I thought you were doing, Molly. You were going to ask Rich for those lists.
Oh, okay.
So I'm actually confused. Right. Now it seems like Marilyn is doing that.
Well, she was going to do 2016-17.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm doing 2018.
Oh, well, 2018 is everything that you planted is in it, right?
I know, but the column that says...
priorities?
Yeah, it says priorities. Isn't that supposed to be where we break it down into these, not just priorities, but do also? Is that what that's for?
No, not quite.
Okay, I thought what we were doing...
You're just doing a rough count of whether it's priority.
Is it important to break down the 2018 trees into which categories they're in or not?
I don't think so. I think what's more important is that we're generally hitting the mark.
Yeah.
And because I think, as Rob points out, one given year, we're not going to really be trying to shoot really...
Right, but on average we are.
So then it would go on to... Okay. Why don't our subcommittee work this out?
We'll talk about it there.
Okay. I will meet with Rich when, what were we going to meet about? Something important.
Tree bits, hardscape, removal.
Yeah. And then I also am still working on this document in the booklet about tree growth, nursery stock recommendations, growth style.
Yeah, one thing to talk about is sitting in tree roots.
Did I jump over that?
No.
Oh, it wasn't on the agenda. Yeah, I don't have to be.
Okay,
do we have the time? Is it time sensitive?
What? So.
Well, we can't talk about it now.
No, all of your homework would be to review the significant tree ordinance as it's rewritten. Don't sell yourself short, okay?
Okay, but I mean, I just want to say, the season begins Wednesday, possibly Friday, Saturday.
And a few, you're doing a few yellowwood pruning.
All of yellowwood can get pruned during the summer. Starting now.
Give you credit for that. I'm emailing people to plant trees, so I'll make sure everybody hears on the email list and re-email you if you missed it for Saturdays going forward. Planting, please join.
All right.
So I'm going to make sure that we change all of our meetings going forward to 4:30. Are we going to 6:30, is that what you like, or 6:45?
No, you mean at 5:45?
4:32.
4:40, no, I am...
Want 4:30 to 6:30?
Well, yeah, go ahead and grab that time space. It's my ideal to end a meeting in an hour and a half. We did not achieve that today, so...
I'm going to work on getting some documentation to Jenna. I can meet about the cost of tree pits and proper soil replacements. I am going to send Lily the volcano mulch flyers. I'm also going to work with Karen to get the website up and running in regards to tree speak and to our
to send the completed document that